Good morning. I'm Deborah Spitalnik, the chair of the New Jersey Family Care Medical Assistance Advisory Council. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the October 21st, 2021 meeting, our last meeting of the calendar year. I want to make sure that people are aware that the meeting was scheduled in accordance with the requirements of the New Jersey Open Public Meetings Act. And I will share with you as our process for this meeting. Let's go to the agenda, please. First, we'll have a welcome and call to order, approval of the minutes, the New Jersey PACE program, family care updates, policy implementation, social drivers of health, and we'll also, as we always do, some planning for the next meeting. We have always prided ourselves on the ability to have interaction with our stakeholders, and we're delighted that as of now, 142 stakeholders are with us this morning in this virtual format. After each presentation, the MAAC members will be unmuted and able to comment or ask questions. Unfortunately, due to the limits of technology and fortunately the size of our audience, we're not able to make that live for stakeholders. So what we ask is that you have if you have questions or comments, you use the Q&A function on your screen, and we will try to, within the limits of time, respond to those questions. Those questions that we can't respond to, that the division can't respond to, I know that that those questions are always taken back and attended to faithfully. So with that, let me ask the members of the MAAC to unmute. And first I'll ask Beverly and Mary Pat to introduce themselves, please.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Bev Roberts, and I'm with the ARC of New Jersey.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mary Pat Angelini. I'm the CEO of Preferred Behavioral Health Group, former legislator.
Thank you. And now I'll turn to Teresa and to Wayne, please.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Teresa Edelstein. I'm one of the senior vice presidents at the New Jersey Hospital Association. And in full disclosure, I also assist with the work of the New Jersey PACE Association.
Thank you. Wayne.
Wayne Vivian, president of the New Jersey Coalition of Mental Health Consumer Organizations of New Jersey.
Thank you. And I'm Deborah Spitalnik. I'm the director of the Bogg Center on Developmental Disabilities at Rutgers Robert Wood Johnson Medical School, where I'm a professor of pediatrics and family medicine and community health. Thank you all for being with us. Our next task for the meeting is to approve the minutes of our past meeting. Do I have either questions or comments, or do I have a motion from the MAAC members for approval?
I move that we accept the minutes as presented.
Thank you, Mary Pat. A second?
I second.
Bev Roberts. With the motion on the floor, do I have approval? Please just say yay.
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 Thank you. And hearing no abstentions no votes, we've approved the past minutes. We now have a guest presentation for the New Jersey Program for All-Inclusive Care for the Elderly, the acronym the PACE program. And we're delighted to welcome Michael de Blasio, who's the president of the PACE Association. Michael, thank you for being with us today.
Absolutely, my pleasure. Thank you for that. It's so great to be here today and speaking with everyone about the PACE program in New Jersey. So I'm the president of the New Jersey PACE Association and also the executive director of the AtlantiCare Life Connection, the AtlantiCare's PACE program. And I've been in PACE in a variety of roles for about just over a decade now. So if I could start by telling you what is a little bit about what is PACE. So PACE goes by a couple of different acronyms. As was previously mentioned, you know, kind of nationally, it's known as a program for all-inclusive care for the elderly. And, you know, the next couple minutes of my talk, I'll really be talking to you about really what that all-inclusive care portion really means. In many states, it's also known as LIFE, which stands for Living Independently for the Elderly. It's really the same program, but you may hear that in a couple of different arenas across the state and across the country. So really what PACE is at its core, it's an integrated system of managed care. And I think what really makes us different from other managed care organizations is that we are the insurer and the provider of care all at the same time. So we provide services and are the insurance instrument for all of our program patients or participants, we call them as well. We have our own network of community specialists. We're not restricted by traditional insurance limitations. I'll tell you a little bit more about what that means in just a few minutes. And we really have a pretty wide array of interdisciplinary team of professionals, about 11 different disciplines that operate within a PACE program. So a little bit about PACE on the national scene. There's 130 PACE organizations nationally with about 275 centers. In total, PACE is really growing. It's growing in New Jersey as well. Currently, there are 6 operational programs, and there's several that are in development over the next year to 18 months or 2 years or so, including Union, Essex, and Ocean counties, and as well as an RFA issued for some uncovered portions of the state in Burlington County. So this map kind of details where PACE is currently and lists kind of which programs have the particular counties to provide PACE services. You can see that the southern part of New Jersey is pretty much covered with PACE programs. And I believe that the state is looking to expand PACE to some of those other counties that perhaps don't have it just yet. So you can see kind of where we are and where we plan to be as a program or could potentially be as a program. So the PACE philosophy and approach. So we coordinate care in all settings, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days out of the year. So whether one of our program participants is here at our center or in their home or in the hospital or in a skilled nursing facility, it's our team that follows that program participant no matter where they are to ensure their care needs are met. You know, really our goal of the program is to keep our participants living independently and safely within the community. You know, I've heard PACE described as a nursing home without walls. So that's one way to think about the program. And I'll get into some more detail about what that means in just a little bit. So again, keeping with our mission and trying to keep our program participants living in the community, we want to prevent or delay facility placement. And as I mentioned, really follow our participants kind of wherever they are. And also, you know, work to make sure that we're reducing unnecessary ED visits and hospitalizations. You know, a lot of PACE program participants are used to going to the emergency department as kind of their primary care office. So we work with them to meet them where they are and meet those medical needs so that they don't have to do that any longer. We do also work to address the participants' goals of care. Those are conversations that we have really upon entry, within a few months of entry to a PACE program. And we also provide care through the end of life to all of our program participants. So we provide hospice level services as well with our own staff typically. So I mentioned the PACE interdisciplinary team and about the 11 or so different disciplines. So when you join a PACE program, you know, these are the folks that really meet your care needs. So we have a primary care provider on site. The PACE programs have a clinic set up within their centers, social workers, physical therapists, registered nurse, recreational therapists, dietitians, occupational therapists, the PACE center manager, home care nurses as well, home health aides, and our transportation staff really all have a say and input into the care plan for our program participants. And when I mentioned earlier that we are the insurer and the provider of care, it's this team of individuals that you see on the screen here that works to develop that care plan and serves as the mechanism to address different service requests that a program participant might have. So they act as the decision maker on how to meet the needs of the participant, and really kind of the informal member of the interdisciplinary team as well as also the participant and their caregivers as well. They participate in the process. So some of the service highlights for PACE, we do medication administration. Yeah, we do that in our PACE centers, which are also adult day centers, as well as housing at clinic and our administrative staff as well. So medication management happens either in our center or at the home. PACE uses a wide variety of electronic devices for dispensing medications in the home as well. Make sure you know, folks are compliant with their medications and to avoid any unnecessary med errors. And we also provide transportation. Transportation is a valuable service for us. We provide transportation to and from our centers. We provide transportation to all specialist appointments. We also provide transportation to other community-based events. We do outings via our recreational department as well. And you know, if someone needed to go to the Board of Social Service or the bank or one of those other you know, kind of key institutions, we would provide transportation to those as well. But one of the things I think is particularly interesting about our transportation team is that we provide door through door transport. So it's door through door, not door to door. We don't just take our participants home and kind of drop them off at the curb and say, good luck getting into your building. We have an escort on all of our vehicles in addition to a driver that goes and assists that particular participant into their home, helps get them settled, and you know, making sure that they're safe and all tucked in and ready to go, basically. And we do that not just from a care perspective, but also we found that it's good to get as many eyes into people's homes as possible. You know, we train our escorts on things to look out for fall risks. So for example, you know, if you're taking one of our program participants in and you see a throw rug on the floor, and if you're an escort, then that's something that you would mention to the program participant, or at least bring back to perhaps the physical therapist or interdisciplinary team that, you know, there's an issue here that might create a fall risk. Or if you see unused medications on the kitchen table, or if you see, you know, two empty vodka bottles in the trash can, that's all valuable information that we take back to our care team and constantly update that care plan for that particular individual. So transportation and our home health aides are really kind of the eyes and ears of the PACE program that relay information back to the team on a regular basis. So Medicare and Medicaid Standards Plus. So I mentioned we're the insurance organization instrument also for our program participants. And typically, you know, we do get most of our funding from Medicare and Medicaid. So by regulation, we have to provide the services that you would get with Medicare and Medicaid. But oftentimes to meet our mission of keeping our program participants out of the hospital unnecessarily and living in the community, we go above and beyond those regulations. And a quick anecdote of an example, I think, that really kind of talks about the power of PACE. You know, we've noticed over the past several summers that folks with COPD exacerbation, when it gets really hot and humid outside, they have an exacerbation and wind up getting going to the emergency room, getting hospitalized, stay in the hospital for a number of days, wind up becoming deconditioned and then, you know, have to go to perhaps some sort of subacute rehab afterwards to get their strength back. So we really saw an uptick in this with our COPD folks when it got hot and humid outside. So one of the things that PACE programs have done was buy window unit air conditioners for folks that didn't have them and hire a handyman to install them. So we do that little bit of kind of outside the box thinking to begin with on the front end, and that avoids that ER visit, it avoids that hospitalization, it avoids that subacute rehab stay, all with just a little bit of ingenuity, I'll say, and a little bit of cash expenditure that's not in within the regulations, you know, but that's the flexibility that PACE has to do things a little bit differently to really impact people's lives. You know, so we also provide behavioral health services as well. Many PACE programs have geriatric psychiatrists that provide clinics on site. We also have licensed clinical social workers that are integrated into the interdisciplinary team for therapeutic services. And many PACE programs also coordinate methadone management as well. So really, when I talk about the PACE services, you know, we have our adult day centers. We have a primary care clinic within our center. I spoke about transportation, home care aides, home care nurses, therapy between physical therapy, occupational therapy, and speech. We're on call 24/7. We always have a physician, nurse, and an administrator on call 24/7 to be able to support our program participants even when the center is actually closed. Not all of our participants come to our center. You can choose to receive all of your services on a home-based set up as well, if that's what you want, and if that's what you know, your care plan dictates, then that's what we'll do. So just some quick information about PACE across the country. You know, PACE typically serves about 22,000 meals a day. Most PACE participants are on about 6 prescriptions. There's about 7 visits to the PACE center and 16 trips per month. So again, that transportation piece of coming to and from the center, going to your specialist appointments, going to an outing. I can tell you that at AtlantiCare last week, we just took about 25 or 30 seniors to the local pumpkin patch to have a nice outing and get them out in the nice fall cool air there. So that was really a nice hit for us. So enrollment-wise, most of our enrollments come from physicians' offices, social service agencies, local hospitals, you know, just different educational events that we do out in the community. So once we get a referral, one of our staff will go out and do a level of care assessment to determine if they meet some of the criteria that we have for clinical eligibility and making sure that the federal criteria is met. So you have to meet a nursing home level of care to enroll in a PACE program. You also have to be over 55. You have to live within the zip code that is serviced by a PACE program and also be able to be serviced safely in the community with PACE services. During the enrollment process, we check for eligibility for Medicaid, Medicare, and we'll work with those individuals to get eligibility going if they haven't yet. And then typically we enroll prior to the 25th. Excuse me, the cutoff is the 25th of the month for enrollment, and then the next month we start on the 1st. So we're coming up on the 25th for October for November enrollees shortly. Yep, so as I mentioned, you need to be over 55, live in our service area, and be able to meet that nursing home level of care. So even though you meet that nursing home level of care criteria to join in PACE, 95% of PACE participants across the country live in the community, don't live in the skilled nursing facility. So I think that's really a pretty impressive number and speaks to the power that PACE can bring to the community, to those folks that want to stay living in their homes. You know, the average age looks like it's about 77. And most of our folks need assistance with about 5 to 6 activities of daily living. You know, so that, and you can see the breakdown is typically about 69% women to 31% men. So even given the frail nature of the population that we serve, PACE across the country has less than one ER visit per year per participant, which I think is really pretty tremendous. The average PACE participant has a acuity rating of more than twice the normal Medicare beneficiary rating. So to be able to have that acuity level be at least two times higher than normal and only one ER visit per year, again, I think speaks to some of the care coordination efforts that PACE is able to put forth, as well as our decreased rehospitalizations, which is significantly lower than the other dual eligible beneficiaries as well. So, again, fewer nursing home admissions and reduced hospitalizations. That's really what we're all about as a PACE program. We found that our program participants really thrive in their communities, and we do our best to make sure that they stay there and continue living in the way that they want to live. So just an update on how PACE changed with the development of COVID. So in March of 2020, the Division of Aging Services put out a memo saying that we need to take certain actions as PACE programs. So essentially all of our centers were closed for socialization. However, we're still open for urgent appointments such as meeting with your primary care provider and or physical therapy, that sort of thing. So we really, as a community and as a group of programs, ramped up our efforts in terms of using telehealth technology instead of doing face-to-face interactions. That continues to be in place now. And really we shifted to providing all of our care in the homes instead of in the centers. So instead of having 50, 60, 80, or 100 seniors in a PACE center during the day, we had to provide care for them in their homes, which logistically was quite complex, but I'm really proud of the way that PACE rose to the challenge to meet the needs of our program participants and keeping them safe. I know that a lot of PACE centers really turned into assembly lines for things like meal kits and medications and just daily supplies and just toiletries and those sort of things. So our participants didn't have to go out anywhere and can remain safe within their home. So we really had kind of an assembly line set up at many of the PACE centers to be able to put those supplies together. And then they were delivered by our own transportation staff as well. Now, fortunately, we've been able to reopen and have program participants come back for socialization to the centers. So we're no longer in that assembly line sort of setup. However, we are taking all the recommended precautions and then some to make sure that we're keeping everybody safe and maintaining all the appropriate infection prevention protocols as well. So, and really when you look at PACE and our response to COVID, relative to some of the things that we saw with other healthcare facilities, I'm really proud of the way that we responded. We maintained low COVID case rates and deaths and low hospitalizations as well. We really worked closely with hospitals, federally qualified health centers, and other different healthcare organizations to provide COVID vaccines very early in the release of the vaccines, and all that organization and coordination to get the seniors the vaccines that they needed. That was all driven by the PACE program in concert with some of those other organizations that I mentioned. So just kind of looking forward and talking about the future of PACE a bit in New Jersey, here's the next two slides are just some remarks from Alterum just about really the way that PACE operates. And I think, we're really looking to expand in PACE, as I mentioned earlier, expand PACE in New Jersey, as I mentioned earlier, with the expansion into different counties and the existing programs really starting to grow. There is also federal legislation that's pending that could make accessibility to PACE significantly easier, and we're you know, that seems to be in the works right now in Congress, and hopefully that will get passed in the not too distant future so that we can really provide more access to police services for people across the country. One thing that I think is pretty exciting about the state of New Jersey, though, we've been working closely with Division of Aging Services to come up with a new initiative for self-directed caregivers, where our program participants can appoint their own caregiver to help provide them services, specifically more things like around what a home health aide would do, generally speaking. So we're looking to get that program up and running, and we've been working closely, like I said, with Division of Aging Services as well. So that'll give just our participants more choice and more options in terms of where they get their care as well within the world of police. So again, just some information there about Alterum, and really talking about how PACE can handle the age wave, the silver tsunami, I've heard it called a couple of times, of what's coming down the pike with us as the baby boomer population continues to age. So here's some contact information for the different PACE programs that are operational currently in the state of New Jersey. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to everyone about PACE. I think it's a great model of care. I think the flexibility that the program is able to provide its participants really sets it apart from some of the other care options that are out there. And really it's that insurance instrument and the provider all at the same time that I think really produce some terrific outcomes for our communities.
Michael, thank you so much for this excellent presentation.
Absolutely.
It's much appreciated. And I will remind stakeholders that the PowerPoint for the whole meeting is posted on the Division of Medical Assistance and Health Services website. And we're going to add that link to the Q&A box right now. Typically we do that after the meeting. And with that, I want to turn to members of the MAAC, and then I will also bring some questions to you that have been raised by stakeholders. And Teresa, let me start with you if you would like to make any comment or ask any questions, given your involvement with PACE.
Oh, thanks very much, Dr. Spitalnik. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, you sound fine. Thank you.
So first of all, I would just echo Mike's comments about just the flexibility and can-do attitude of the PACE organizations throughout these last 18 months. It's been remarkable to watch here in New Jersey, but also across the country. One other thing I just want to mention is New Jersey, the Division of Aging Services specifically, has been part of a National Academy of State Health Policy Initiative on PACE, which members of the PACE organizations in New Jersey have had the privilege to be a part of as part of the state's work group. And we are really excited about some of the initiatives that we'll undertake together on enrollment that will help us grow PACE in New Jersey. So there's a lot of good things to look forward to in our state with respect to PACE implementation and expansion. And we look forward to the continuing partnership. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you very much. Beverly, you have a question.
Yes, I do. And thank you so much. This was a wonderful presentation. I had heard about PACE before, but really didn't know much about it. So my questions have to do with individuals who have an intellectual or developmental disability. My first question, I'm not sure if Mike can answer, but I am aware that if somebody with IDD wanted to get MLTSS services, they could not have MLTSS and DDD services at the same time. So I don't know if that also applies to somebody getting DDD services. Could they have PACE services if they meet the other criteria, including, you know, having the nursing facility level of care? So that's my first question. But the second question is, We do sometimes get contacted by people who are much older, never had DDD services. Maybe they're being cared for at this point by a sibling. They could be in their 50s or older. Parents have passed away. And it's very hard for them to get, for the sibling, let's say, to get the documentation that this disability occurred before the age of 22, which is what would be required for them to have DDD services. So I'm wondering, in a situation like that, would somebody with IDD, who, if they had the documentation, could be served by DDD, but it's really difficult sometimes to get that documentation, would they be able to enroll, again, with nursing facility level of care requirement, could they enroll in PACE?
Yeah, I don't believe that you can get DDD services and PACE at the same time. Teresa may have a better answer for you on that than I do. In terms of documentation that's required, if they don't have the DDD services, and meet those other eligibility requirements, I would think that they would be eligible for PACE. But I don't know, Teresa, do you have any insight on that?
So Michael, I think the answer to the first question was correct, that you can't be on the DDD waiver services and also in PACE. But we can delve into that a little bit more. On the second question, I agree that if they don't have the documentation to satisfy eligibility for the DDD waiver services and they meet PACE criteria, yes. I think the other important piece is the federal legislation that Mike mentioned that is pending would also expand the types of populations PACE could serve, and that would include more individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities. So these are things where, you know, we're working on from a policy perspective at the national level with the National PACE Association.
Thank you very much. And then hopefully we can get updated, you know, as that additional federal legislation goes through. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Beverly. Mary Pat Angelini, please.
I'm very familiar with the Beacon of Life in Monmouth County on the grounds of Fort Monmouth, and it's a beautiful facility. I had a question, two short questions. One about marketing. Is there a concerted marketing effort, or is it just a matter of reaching out to different physicians and practices? And then my second question is, Michael, you mentioned there was federal legislation to moving that will make it easier to access. What do you see as the barriers currently to access PACE? Thank you.
Sure. Yeah. So I think just in terms of your first question, in terms of marketing, and we don't really do much direct-to-consumer marketing, but we do a lot of educational sessions for the community, and also we work with professional referral sources as well. So that's really where most of our marketing efforts are focused. In terms of barriers to enrollment, that legislation, I think, really tries to address some of the expense that you might incur if you wanted to join a PACE program but weren't necessarily Medicaid eligible. That's really, I think, the focus, in addition to serving other populations. But in terms of barriers, I think that's one of the main barriers that's out there from preventing PACE from really kind of expanding out across the state and country.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you. Wayne Vivian has a question, please. Wayne, if you unmute and pose your question.
Yes, my question is regarding behavioral health services. I know MLTSS hasn't had that much success with providing their senior or the people who have MLTSS with behavioral health services. How does PACE intend to provide key behavioral health services to your members?
So there's really several different mechanisms we use for behavioral health services. I mentioned the psychiatric clinics that often go on inside the PACE program. So those clinics are all organized by PACE staff. We provide transportation to and from those clinics. We provide the home health aides in the morning, perhaps to help, you know, one of those program participants get ready to be able to make sure that they attend their visit. We also have had, I can speak specifically for my PACE organization, the psychiatrists do home visits as well. And we've also had our licensed clinical social workers do therapy sessions in the home. So wherever our participants are, that's where we go to meet their needs. So whether that's in the center, that's in their home, they're at a relative's house, you know, we are out in the community as well as our center to meet those needs. And I think also, you know, just in terms of medication compliance and the oversight that we provide with some of our home health nurses and, you know, some of the tools that we use for medication compliance also really help specifically with some of our behavioral health diagnoses as well.
Are your caseworkers that actually see the your participants, are they trained to spot mental health issues?
Absolutely, yes.
Because how do the participants get to the attention of a psychiatrist or?
So we have, you know, social workers as part of our licensed social workers, as part of our interdisciplinary team. We also have several LCSWs as well. You know, most PACE staff go through kind of a mental health first aid training as well, just to kind of be able to notice some of the indicators that may result in pulling in a social worker as well. So that's, and I think it's the number of touches that we have with our program participants, you know, so, you know, they might come in the center, you know, 5 days a week and also get home care from us. And, you know, that, so there's a lot of interaction as well. So those frequent interactions as well, you know, if there is someone that's having some issues or concerns, you know, it's brought to the team's attention pretty quickly.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure thing.
Thank you. Very briefly, a few questions from stakeholders. One question was about dental care, which was listed in one of your slides about covered services. Sure. Question concretely, do we have a sense of timeline for expanding PACE in New Jersey? And I would ask you and also the Division of Medical Assistance and Health Services. And then there are questions about the relationship between managed long-term services and supports and PACE. So that seems to be a recurring set of questions about MLTSS.
Gotcha. Okay, so the dental care piece. So we do provide dental care all the way from things like regular cleanings to dentures to oral surgery if the need be. That's, you know, all within the PACE package of services of things that we do offer to our program participants. Expansion wise, I think we had the dates for the Burlington County expansion there, and I believe the other counties that are potentially being considered. Teresa, I want to say it's in the next perhaps year or two. I don't know that an official timeline has been put out by the state just yet.
Yeah, you're accurate, Mike. There is definitely a timeline in mind for bringing PACE to all of the remaining counties. Demographic data will definitely help shape which counties come next in the queue. The RFA process is detailed, and we want to make sure as a state we get this right. So, but I think over the next 2 years, you know, we anticipate we'll see many more PACE organizations coming online, many more RFAs to be responded to.
Great. Thank you. And before we close out this segment, Greg Woods, did you have a comment from DMAAC's perspective to share with us about this, please?
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Spadalnik. The only thing I just wanted to quickly say, first of all, thank you for this great presentation, but I did want to just, before the moment passed by, I know, Wayne, you had mentioned some concerns about the integration of behavioral health into MLTSS. And I did just want to mention, you know, that's a concern we've heard a lot. It's a concern we've heard a lot historically. It's also a concern we've heard a lot just in response to our draft 1115 proposal. And in particular, we've had some requests in some of the comments we received on the 1115 proposal to delve more deeply into sort of what the picture looks like for behavioral health with MLTSS and also with populations in our Division of Developmental Disabilities Waiver Programs. And so I just did want to mention, we've heard that request. We're looking at that data now, and we intend to share for this group, and I think in other forums in the pretty near future, sort of, you know, what that looks like from a data perspective. And so that's something our team is working on intensively. So I did just want to mention that. I think, you know, I think there's, as we delve into this data, I think it's a complicated picture. And, you know, look forward to having that conversation. So did just want to mention that.
Thank you very much, Greg, for that. And you've anticipated one of my agenda items for our next meetings going forward. And with that, I want to thank Michael DeBuz both for the presentation you've given us and for the work you do day in and day out, and especially the challenges of COVID and how PACE has met that. Thank you for being with us, Teresa. Thank you for your work in this. And we'll now turn to New Jersey Family Care enrollment. And as I remind people, these slides are posted if that's helpful for participation. And Greg, I will turn to you more formally. Greg Woods is the Chief Innovation Officer for the Division of Medical Assistance and Health Services. Greg, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Spodalnik. So if we can go to the next slide, I think we wanted to just give a quick update, as we've done for this group a couple of times in the past, on where we are on overall New Jersey Family Care enrollment. As you can see on this slide, as of September, which is the most recent month we have data for, our total enrollment was a bit above 2 million across all of our populations. This represents an increase of around 350,000 since our pre-pandemic level, or that's put another way, a bit over a 20% increase in our total enrollment. So that's quite significant. And this continues the trend that we've seen since spring of 2020 of fairly consistently increasing enrollment. You know, as we've discussed with this group before, it can be somewhat challenging to disentangle the causes of this change. In particular, it's not possible to precisely isolate the impact of the ongoing public health emergency and some of the continuous enrollment policies that go with that versus other changes that are happening in the state, including, you know, demographic and economic changes. So I don't have a precise way. I know the question has arisen before. I don't have a precise way to say how much of this is driven by the fact that we have continuous enrollment in place versus how much of this is driven by other factors. That said, you know, we continue to believe that the largest driver is that continuous enrollment piece, which, just as a reminder, this is the policy that during the federal public health emergency, which is ongoing, you know, we are not, members are only disenrolled from our program in very limited circumstances, you know, voluntarily or in the case of death or moving out of state. So you know, looking at the totality of the information we have, we continue to believe that that's the primary driver. I will note that recently, in the past week, the federal government formally extended the public health emergency for another 90-day period. So that takes us from this month into the middle of January. You know, it's always possible, though it's not likely, that they could end sooner than that. But you know, they have made it clear that there will be significant notice, at least a couple of months' notice, before that happens. So I think, you know, until we hear otherwise, we are assuming we're continuing to operate in that public health emergency and with the policies that go with that. So that's probably a good transition to Jen, who I think, among other things, is going to talk about some of our planning for when the public health emergency ends and also some of our broader work on eligibility determination and redetermination.
Thank you, Greg. So we wanted to talk to you a little bit about that work that is going on right now at the counties and at our health benefits coordinator, Conduent. You know, the information we've got for you here in black on this page is information we've provided to you at past MAAC meetings. The blue is where we're giving you a little bit of an update from recent times. So the eligibility determining agencies are continuing to renew eligibility even while no one is being terminated from the program during the public health emergency. When they find a case that appears to be ineligible, and that can include people who did not respond to the mailing at all, but also people who report a higher income, those cases are getting a special flag so that we can revisit them at the end of the public health emergency. So as Greg said, no one is being terminated from the program during the public health emergency, except for voluntary cases, people who have moved out of state, et cetera. What's new now, which we wouldn't have shared with you before because CMS put out this new guidance in August, is a little bit of a timeline change. So for cases where we put that flag in the system, we believe this case is ineligible. We've done the renewal. We're flagging it as ineligible. We will conduct another redetermination at the end of the PHE. Every state will follow this policy. And we will have 12 months to catch up on all those redeterminations. So this is an expanded timeline from what we were looking at with previous guidance. That is a sigh of relief for all of us, I think, on all sides. And our intention here in New Jersey is to align that redetermination activity to the pre-existing renewal dates for each case. So that spreads the work over the 12 months that we have as much as possible, sort of maintaining that cadence that was already in place. So a little bit of new information there from CMS, but as Greg said, you know, we're still in the public health emergency. So that maintenance of effort still applies. And the other thing we wanted to talk to you about today was system improvements that we have been making over the course of the public health emergency. We had wheels in motion on a bunch of changes when the pandemic surprised us all with new priorities. And we've kept those wheels in motion. So we're now benefiting from system improvements that have phased in over the course of the last couple of years and wanted to give you a little bit of an update on that. Our theme around all of this, which has been sort of prominent in our work, and so we wanted to sort of make it prominent in this discussion, is energy follows focus. So we really need to work closely with our county partners to make sure that we were all focused on the same things and really trying to move the needle together in very consistent ways. And so one thing we have done is move all the county welfare agencies to a single shared platform that we can now use for intake, processing, and tracking of applications. That is a huge technical lift on the part of our systems teams and everyone from, you know, eligibility policy here at DMOS to frontline workers at the counties who are entering applications that may have been received on paper from members or who are looking at applications that came in online. So those enhancements to our system have let us standardize work processes that varied across 21 counties and have simplified eligibility determination overall. The team has new system enhancements in the works. So there's still more to come there, but we're already seeing the benefit of the work we've done. And one of the things I thought might be interesting to you is, you know, we are tracking, it is important that we track the effective, efficient turnaround of eligibility processing so we don't end up with backlogs. And it's also important that we work closely with families who are potentially trying to collect information that is needed to process their application. So if the family is working with us and they say, we need a little more time, we've established a good cause indicator that lets the county tell us, this is a case where we're working directly with the family. And so we're keeping an eye on that to make sure that it doesn't go on forever, but it does sort of, it stops the clock on that case so that we're really watching effective, efficient turnaround times and also accounting for, look, sometimes there are extenuating circumstances. And we recognize that, you know, that people focus is really important. Another thing that we have done during this time, really very quickly, actually, at the start of the public health emergency, we established what I think of as a cadence of accountability with our counties, where we were getting together to be accountable to one another on a weekly basis to make sure that we would not lose ground during the public health emergency. Now, as you know, every workplace in America has been impacted by the public health emergency, and the counties are no exception to that. What we needed, though, and certainly DMOS is no exception either, what we needed was to make sure that as we were finding new ways of working and keeping the wheels in motion on these system improvements, we really needed to be talking to each other a lot. And so we set up this cadence of meetings. It's now biweekly, but initially was weekly. And we look at what I call a compelling scoreboard. If anyone has read The Four Disciplines of Execution, it's a phenomenal book for trying to track a project like this. And you can also sort of Google that. I really like the compelling scoreboard because it says to me, we've got so much data. Here is what we need to pay attention to. And this is going to tell us the story. Then we can use the rest of the data to dig into the details. And so that goes along with energy follows focus, right? Then we have really candid discussion in those conversations so that we're helping counties sort of address some of the challenges they're running into either on their end or on ours. And that has resulted in efficiency improvements and turnaround time improvements. I'm about to talk to you about that. But really what it means at the bottom line is we're getting coverage in place for people faster. You will see that in the data I'm going to show you in a moment, but we have knocked out backlogs, turnaround times have improved, the counties have really worked very closely with us on this, the progress is tremendous. We have new dashboards on the way, and as I mentioned before, the technical team is working hard on continuing updates in the system that will make us more efficient and improve performance of the system overall. So let's dig in for just a minute. I'm going to give you a little bit of data. Bear with me. These couple of bars, or this bar chart, represents processing volume. These are MAAC cases, so not our age of blind and disabled cases, but the ones that process in this format called MAAC, which you don't have an hour to talk about. But these are the non-ABD cases. This is all counties. And what you're seeing here is processing volume, left and right is July of 2020 and July of 2021. You see the colors are representing the amount of time it took for those cases to process. And so there's a lot behind the numbers here, but a couple of things that we really wanted to point out to you. For one thing, if you look at the top, the yellow and blue bar rows, those are cases that waited too long. They're cases that wait too long. And we really want a reduced wait time. There are sometimes reasons why cases end up waiting, but they shouldn't be waiting a long time, especially in the MAAC zone. So what you see in the difference between July of 2020 and 2021 is a reduction in that yellow and blue zone, a pretty noticeable reduction. And that really is counties being more aware when they have a backlog, tracking the data. Like I said, those compelling scoreboards are telling us here's where we need action. The directors are all over that, and it is reducing delays in folks getting that Medicaid card in their hand or the NJ Family Care card in their hand. And then at the bottom on the 2021 side, you see quicker turnaround times where that beige row and the blue row at the bottom grow. Those are the cases that are turning around faster. More cases turning around faster, less cases backlogged or delayed. And more work to come on that, but really significant progress. Here we are looking at the ABD cases, age, blind, and disabled. These cases take longer to process. There are more steps involved, But also, it's really important to mention to you, when we look at July of 2020 versus 21 for this group, we were adopting the new system here over the course of that period. So you see the volume increasing because more cases were being entered into that new system. And that's important to point out because we didn't have, you know, some significant jump in applications with our ABD group. That increased volume in this report represents folks moving ABD processing activity into the new system. Hopefully that makes sense. But then also what you see here is that yellow bar growing, where the efficiency of the new system, the standardization of some of this process, watching those key metrics is helping us also have quicker turnaround times on this side of the house. So always more work to do, more work to come, but we're feeling good about the progress that we see here.
Thank you so much. And thank you for that wonderful walkthrough of data, which is so difficult to process when we're first seeing it. At this juncture, I will ask members of the MAAC if you have questions for Assistant Commissioner Jacobs, for Chief Innovation Officer Woods, any questions about enrollment and maintenance of effort and the redetermination and eligibility process.
I would just say just a comment, not a question, but just regarding getting all 21 counties on the same platform. I just cannot imagine what a Herculean task that was. So congratulations.
Thank you. Heidi and the team worked really hard with the county directors to make that happen. We're excited.
Anyone else from the MAAC, questions or comments?
Yes, I have a question.
Beverly, please.
Okay, thanks very much. So thank you so much. And it's absolutely wonderful news about the improved turnaround time for the applications for MAGI and ABD. So thank you. That is absolutely fabulous news. I have a very quick question about what's going to happen again after the PHE is over. And there are different kinds of situations, of course, that are going to occur. But one thing that I'm quite concerned about is people who were enrolled in non-ABD because they didn't have Medicare at the time. And that's not just the IDD folks. That's maybe quite a few people. But they did start to get Medicare during the period of the PHE. What is going to happen with those folks when it's clear that they are not eligible for that category any longer, but at least for the IDD folks, there's a very good chance that they would be eligible for a different type of Medicaid, including Medicaid through the DDD system?
Yep, good question. And Heidi, I think you and your team have spent some time on this topic. Would you like to take the answer there?
I think the key is to get people to respond to the renewal so that we can see the best program that they're eligible for. During the PHE, because of the MOE, the maintenance of effort, and not terminating anyone, we have been putting people into categories to save their eligibility. And so it's critical at this juncture that people respond to their renewal so that we can put them into the correct program and not lose anybody who's truly eligible.
Thank you. So if somebody is getting DDD services, is that something that you all would know? Because this population is probably a relatively small percentage of your overall numbers of folks who have started to get Medicare. So how will it be known that a particular person who did start to get Medicare is getting DDD services?
So we have reports that come through that let us know who is now getting Medicare. We work very closely with the DD division and Brian's group. And it's important when applications come through that door that we help shepherd them to where they need to be. And that's another population also that needs sometimes when we renew them, realize they need to move on to MLTSS program from the DD program.
Okay, probably relatively small numbers of that, but mm-hmm. And sure, anything is possible. Okay.
But we don't want to lose anybody that serves beyond the program.
right?
Okay, thank you very much, Heidi.
Any other questions or comments from the MAAC at this point? Assistant Commissioner, we have a couple of questions about good cause indicators and trying to take a deeper dive into understanding why people haven't been able to respond.
One of the challenges with eligibility work is that it requires a one-on-one interaction. And so we have made the good cause indicator available. The directors know that, supervisors know that, making sure that we're always communicating with the folks who are the eligibility workers who are doing this work is important. We've had those conversations. And so we feel like we have prepped folks for always offering that extension when it's appropriate. And sometimes we get individual cases where a worker made a mistake and didn't offer the extension or didn't approve the extension. Sometimes it's not appropriate. So what's helpful to us when folks feel that they're seeing a pattern of that is to get a few examples so that we can look at what county did it come from. Was that about the policy at the county, the way that the county is handling extensions, or was it about the way a particular worker handled an extension request? And then we can work with the counties directly. It always depends on the scale of the issue, right? Sometimes it is the county, sometimes it's a worker. Sometimes we see a problem across many counties and we end up having that conversation on our biweekly calls. So it is really helpful if folks are able to provide us with any examples where they felt like an extension was appropriate, not provided.
Thank you so much for that response. And as I ask Assistant Commissioner and Greg Woods to stay at the virtual podium, I will also want to thank Heidi Smith and her team for all their efforts that have made such a productive difference. And with in conclusion of our updates, we'll now move to some policy implementation issues. And we'll start off with the 1115 comprehensive waiver demonstration renewal. And I turn to Greg Woods again. Thank you, Greg.
Thank you. So I wanted to give a quick status update on our 1115 renewal process. And I will plan to be very brief here since we discussed this topic at length during a special MAAC meeting last month. And we don't have major substantive updates since that meeting, but did want to give everyone an update where we stand with the process. So just as a reminder about what we're talking about, our 1115 demonstration is how the federal government gives us authority to run various critical parts of our program, our managed care delivery system, our home and community-based services programs, and is also a vehicle that allows us to work with the federal government to test various innovative approaches to running the Medicaid and CHIP programs. Our current demonstration period, so our current authorization, is approved through next June. And so therefore we're at the time when we need to negotiate a renewal with our federal partners at the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. So as part of that process, we posted a draft proposal, a draft renewal proposal on our website last month on September 10th. And we requested public comment. And that state public comment period, it was 30 days or maybe 31 days. And it ended on October 11th, so a little over a week ago. We received more than 100 comments from the public and from stakeholders. So first, we want to say thank you for all of that input. It's incredibly helpful to us and an incredibly important part of the process. Right now, my team, we are very intensively reviewing those comments and working on identifying where there are opportunities potentially to modify our proposal. Whether there are updates, whether there are just areas where we need to make some clarifications because our intent or our meaning may not have been clear based on some of the comments that we received. So that's where we are right now. Once that process is complete, once we have reviewed all of the comments, assessed what changes we want to make moving forward, we will then submit an updated final proposal to CMS for their review. I will note that proposal will include summaries of the comments we've received and responses, where appropriate to those comments. So we'll submit that to CMS. CMS typically takes a couple of weeks to review that proposal and determine whether it has all the required elements and is complete. Once they've done that, they will post it publicly on their website on medicaid.gov. And then there will be another public comment period, which is called the federal public comment period, which will allow the public and stakeholders to comment to CMS about the final version that we submitted. And you know, once that public comment period is over, then we work with CMS to negotiate the final approved version. So that's all to say, we're continuing to move forward in the process. As we move forward, we will continue to update the MAAC and continue to provide the public with information on where we are. So please do stay tuned. But more to come on this front.
Thank you. And let's move to the American Rescue Plan Enhanced Federal Match for Home and Community-Based Services. And again, Greg, thank you. We rely on you for this.
Great, thank you. So now we're gonna turn to a different topic. As Dr. Spitalnik said, this is the Enhanced Federal Funding for Home and Community-Based Services that was provided to states as part of the American Rescue Plan. So just to remind everyone, so as part of the American Rescue Plan, Congress provided a 10% increase in the Medicaid FMAP rate for home and community-based services. So to put that in less technical language, Congress effectively said that the federal government would temporarily, so for 1 year, from April of this year to March of next year, assume responsibility for an additional 10% of Medicaid expenditures on long-term care services provided in the community above and beyond what the federal government is ordinarily responsible for. So in essence, the share of those expenditures that the federal government assumed responsibility for went up, and sort of at the same time, therefore, the sort of the state responsibility goes down. Now those enhanced federal dollars came with some significant requirements attached. So specifically, in order to claim those dollars, states were required, all states were required to demonstrate that we are taking those additional dollars and reinvesting them specifically into home and community-based services. So this wasn't something that states could take those dollars and plug an unrelated budget hole. It really needed to be reinvested in those services. And we were given 3 years to make those reinvestments. So the enhanced dollars are for 1 year, but then with those dollars, you have 3 years through the spring of 2024 to make those reinvestments. In order to demonstrate compliance with that requirement, so New Jersey and all states, we were required to submit a spend plan to our federal partners at CMS showing how we plan to reinvest those dollars. So what specific purposes related to home and community-based services were we planning to put those dollars to? And many of you may remember back in June, May and June, we ran a very accelerated process or in the summer to seek public and stakeholder input on that spend plan. And it was, I say, a very accelerated process because there was a very quick deadline. CMS, I think, originally gave us a month to turn that around. And if I'm remembering correctly, we maybe got a couple of additional weeks, but it was very brief and we had to come up with a plan. So we ended up submitting a spend plan to the federal government, to CMS, on July 12th. That plan is posted on our website and the link is here on the slide. And then we, after submitting that plan, the next step in the process is for our federal partners at CMS to review it and send us their response. So at the end of last month, on September 29th, we received a partial approval from CMS on our spend plan. So what does partial approval mean? It means that CMS approved most of the items in our spend plan and gave us the go-ahead to start implementation. For a smaller number of items in the spend plan, CMS had some additional clarifying questions for us that it needed responses to before it could approve those items. I just want to note here, partial approval is not at all unique to New Jersey. I don't think CMS has published sort of any comprehensive list of where all of the states stand, but our understanding talking to other states is partial approval is by far the most common outcome of CMS's review of state spend plans. So we're not at all unique here. So as I said, CMS sent us that partial approval. And what I'd like to do now is just take a minute to walk through the specific items in our spend plan and do a very brief tour of the world about where we stand with each of them. So first, this slide shows all of the items that CMS has approved, so that were approved and we were given the go ahead to begin implementing as part of that partial approval. Before I talk through the specifics, I do just want to briefly note that, you know, broadly speaking, the things on this slide fall into a couple of buckets. I would say some of the things on this list, particularly rate increases, they're fairly straightforward and relatively simple for us to implement. And so for those items, we're moving ahead rapidly. You'll see there are generally, in most cases, there are specific implementation dates, target implementation dates included here. So that's one bucket of items. There are other items where we propose more innovative or novel approaches to supporting HCBS. And, you know, we had to put that proposal together, as I said, very quickly. Now that we have CMS approval, we're really focused on fleshing out our proposal and nailing down some of the operational details that in many cases we didn't have time to work through when we submitted the initial spend plan. So you'll see for some of these items, we have TBD listed as an implementation date. The reason for that is we are right now very focused on working through what will the details look like. And as we complete that work and as we sort of fill in more details, we will certainly share more information with the MAAC and with stakeholders generally on what the timeline looks like for implementing those items. So with all of that said, I'll quickly walk through the things that are listed on this table. First of all, there are actually a couple of lines here around personal care assistance rate increases. So the first one is an increase of the hourly PCA rate that Medicaid pays to agencies to $22 an hour. This was actually part of the enacted fiscal year 22 budget. So it has already gone into effect, went into effect back in July. Now that we have CMS approval, we will have funding to sustain that rate increase through the period through 2024. So that's already in place, and now we have the funding that we'll be able to continue that. In addition, now that we have the approval from CMS, we are planning an additional rate increase of a further $1. So that will take us to $23 an hour for the personal care assistance services. We are targeting an implementation of date of that for January 1st, 2022. So coming up in a couple of months. So at the moment we're at $22. We expect to go to $23 on January 1st. Next, moving down that table, the PPP rate increase. This is our self-directed service program for individuals in MLTSS. The change here is to increase the budgeted rate for PCA services that are administered through the personal preference program, so that are self-directed by the beneficiary. That rate, and this is the rate that is used to determine the budgets that are available for members in that program, will be increased to $19 an hour. And that also we are looking to make that effective on January 1st coming up. Then turning to assisted living, so there are a couple of assisted living items here. First, there's the rate increase that was included as part of the enacted budget for this fiscal year. That was, I think, that was a $10 rate increase that was effective July 1st. And similar to what I said about PCA, by having approval from CMS for that funding to be included moving forward, that allows us to sustain that rate increase through the time period through 2024. In addition, we proposed as part of our spend plan an additional tiered rate increase, which would specifically increase expenditures on assisting living facilities serving a high percentage of New Jersey family care beneficiaries. For that one, implementation planning is still ongoing. And so we don't have a targeted effective date yet, but that's something we're working actively on and hope to have more information on soon. Moving down the list, we had in our spend plan some dollars devoted to encouraging nursing facility transitions to community settings. These dollars are intended to encourage increased and accelerated transitions of New Jersey family care beneficiaries from custodial nursing facilities back to the community, which is one of the goals of our managed long-term services and supports program. Exactly how these dollars will be targeted, we're still working through some of the details there. I think we expect to work closely with our managed care organizations on that one, and we don't have a target date yet, but so more to come on that. Going to the next item, enhancements to the No Wrong Door system. This is funding that's intended to ensure that to support and enhance the existing community-based resources that are available, to make sure they're working in a coordinated way to educate and make sure information is available to all members or potential members about their options, their long-term care options. This one, we're working very closely with our partners in the Division of Aging Services. And again, implementation planning is ongoing. I don't think we have a target rollout date yet, but we hope to have more information soon. Also approved as part of our spend plan was a one-time payment to providers of services for individuals with traumatic brain injury. This is intended as a one-time funding to offset some of the costs associated for those providers with the public health emergency. Here again, we're working through some of the implementation details and hope to have more information soon. Next item is a support coordinator rate increase. This is for support coordinators under our HCBS waiver programs administered by the Division of Developmental Disabilities, who function as case managers within those programs. So this funding will increase the rates for those providers. We have been working with our partners at the Division of Developmental Disabilities. They are targeting implementation of November 1st, so coming up very soon. I do want to caveat that that's a target date. I know they are working very intensively to do all of the operational steps and legal steps we need to do to make that a reality. So I think November 1st is a target date. If there are updates to that, you know, we would be sure to communicate that with stakeholders. And then lastly, on our approved list, there are some dollars for home health workforce development, which is something we heard very clearly from stakeholders back during the process we ran in the summer. The goal of this funding is to enable new and expanded initiatives around recruitment and retention of the home health workforce. And here too, we're working with our partners across our department. Implementation planning is ongoing, and we expect to have more details on that, in both in terms of what we're going to do and when, very shortly. So if we want to go to the next slide, I do want to turn to the shorter list of items where we don't yet have full CMS approval, where we have some outstanding questions we still need to respond to from our federal partners. Just as a rough timeline update, we are working actively on getting that additional information to our federal partners and expect to send them responses to their question in the next few weeks. And we're hopeful that we will receive full approval for these items, relatively quickly thereafter. I don't want to go into all of the weedy details for this group and today about every question that CMS has asked. I will say in general, the kinds of questions they have asked tend to be fairly technical and seem to be oriented towards confirming that these proposals really fit within their legal red lines and are compliant with the guidance, and that in particular, that some of these things that we're proposing fit within the definition of a permissible home and community-based service as defined for this purpose. So we're very focused on getting that information to them. I would say in general, we certainly don't view approval as guaranteed, but we are cautiously optimistic that we will ultimately have approval for all or at least most of these remaining items. And we're going to continue that conversation with CMS. So with that conversation, I will go quickly and just run through what these items are where we're still waiting approval. There is funding that we proposed around person-centered planning. Our goal here would be to enable enhanced and expanded training for the various folks who work, including in our managed care organizations, on our MLTSS program, and make sure that they are really mindful and well trained on the principles of person-centered planning. So more to come on that. The next item here is what we were calling healthy homes. This is a particularly innovative and new thing for us, where we are looking to use some of these dollars to actually develop affordable housing units for New Jersey family care members, where how a housing situation is affecting their ability to live and thrive in the community. This is separate from, but aligned to some of the proposals we included in our draft 1115 renewal around housing related services. This is all part of a broader strategy. And in this case, sort of, you know, referencing what I said earlier, we're working in particular to make CMS comfortable and figure out a way to move forward with this that complies with some of the statutory prohibitions that exist in federal law against Medicaid funding room and board. So we're working that through with our federal partners. And also I should say with various other partners around the state who work on housing issues who have been really, really critical on this project. The next item is enhanced rates for applied behavioral analysis, ABA services for children with autism spectrum disorders. The proposal here would be to increase the rate there to $15 per 15 minute unit. We're still working through with CMS some of the details there. We also proposed a rate increase for the JAC program. That's the Jersey Assistance for Community Caregiving, which is run by our partners at the Division of Aging Services, and which enables non-Medicaid eligible individuals at risk of placement in a nursing facility to receive services and remain in the community. And this is broadly aligned with the proposal with the item that's in our approved list around increased rates for personal care assistance services. Moving down the list, we also had a proposal that we developed in partnership with our partners at the Department of Children and Families around intensive mobile services for the IDD population. The proposal here would be to establish a mobile treatment team to deliver interventions and support to youth with IDD and with co-occurring needs within their home and community. So there too, we're working through with CMS to get them some additional information about how that program would function. And then the last item on the list is the Behavioral Health Promoting Interoperability Program. Just as a reminder, previously we had run a Promoting Interoperability Program using state dollars focused on connecting providers of SUD services through the implementation and upgrade of EHR systems. This funding is intended to extend and expand that expand it to other behavioral health providers who weren't eligible for the previous program. And this one, I will note, was also part of our 1115 renewal proposal. There are a couple of different sort of CMS approvals that are working together here. So we're continuing to work through our federal partners on that. So that's my summary of where we stand on the enhanced federal match for HCBS services. Dr. Spitalnik, I don't know if you want to pause here or if you'd like me to keep going to the next topic.
I do, and thank you for that. One concrete question before I open this to the members of the MAAC is, do you have an approximate date for submitting the waiver to CMS? I know you're working intensively with the comments.
I don't have a specific date to share at this moment. I think, you know, we would hope to be submitting that final proposal, you know, in the next few weeks or month. But I don't have a specific date. And I think it will depend on sort of, you know, as we work through some of the substantive issues that commenters raised.
Thank you for that. And with that, if members of the MAAC have questions or comments about either the waiver renewal or the FMAP increase, this would be the time to raise them. Any questions?
Yeah, thank you very much. So Greg, thank you. This was great information, a lot of information. I'm particularly excited about what you said about the intensive mobile services for children with IDD, and certainly hope that the remaining issues with CMS can be resolved as soon as possible. I have a very quick question, because you provided so much information. When you talked about the increase in the rate for PPP being increased to $19 an hour, I'm not sure if I heard you say that was specific to people in MLTSS. I believe it should be for everybody who receives Medicaid on that PPP increase, but I just wanted to confirm with you that it's for everybody who is receiving Medicaid and who receives PPP services.
Yeah, thanks, Bev. I think, and Jen, you should confirm. I think I misspoke, and that's right. So thank you for correcting me there. That it's certainly individuals with an MLTSS, but it's anyone in the PPP program, any Medicaid enrollee. So I apologize, and thank you for catching that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bev and Greg. Any other questions for Greg at this juncture? And I will just share a comment from stakeholders, which is, as these opportunities are being implemented, are there junctures or opportunities for stakeholders to work collaboratively in implementing these initiatives for stakeholder input, not only in the choices that have been made and approved, but in the actual implementation?
Yeah, I think the answer to that is certainly yes. I think, you know, sort of what that will look like will depend a little bit on the specific initiative. You know, there are going to be different, I think, stakeholder communities involved in different initiatives. But our intention is very much to work with the relevant stakeholders on each of these and reach out. So yes, please stay tuned. If anyone who is listening to this meeting, if there's a specific initiative you want to be more involved with, please do feel free to reach out to us, and you know, we really welcome that, and we can make sure to get you connected. But I think we also intend, as we move forward with the various items on this spend plan, to reach out to various members of the community. Jen, I don't know if there's anything you want to add on that.
No, I agree with you, Greg. Absolutely, it's been part of the process all along, and so we'll keep it up that way.
Thank you, and we'll certainly add that as a forward agenda item to keep track of that. Thank you so much. You will now look to the provider relief funds information. And again, Greg, we're not letting you take a breath. Thank you for this.
Thank you. So I do want to turn now to give some very high level updates on the COVID-19 provider relief funding that is currently being offered by the federal government. Before I dive into this, I do want to emphasize this is a federal program. It's not administered by DMAS or any other part of the state government. And we're not the subject matter experts on every detail of implementation, which can get quite technical. This program is administered by HRSA, which is a federal agency within HHS. So I will say, you know, if you have questions, we do strongly recommend that you go to HRSA to get them answered. That said, we did just want to spend a few minutes today on this, since it is an important opportunity for providers in New Jersey. And also because while the program is not administered by Medicaid or by the state, providers may qualify for funding under this program, partially at least by virtue of having participated in NJ Family Care. So we wanted to talk about it, make sure people are aware, but I do want to emphasize this is a federal program, and that's probably in general the best place to go for specific or detailed questions. So without going into a ton of detail, and there's more on this slide, I did just want to note there have been three previous phases of the provider relief fund that the federal government has administered. I think should be familiar to many of you. Across those three phases, they've distributed, you know, somewhere north of $75 billion to providers nationally. And, you know, there's a lot of complexity. Those dollars, they were distributed on a range of factors, including lost revenue during the pandemic, as well as some of it was distributed based on total historical Medicare and Medicaid reimbursement. So those three stages were in the past. Now HRSA has announced the fourth stage. And I just want to say really loudly and clearly up front, the deadline to apply for that fourth stage for providers is October 26th, which is just 5 days away. And it's not, you know, the application does require some significant documentation. So I am hopeful that most of the providers on this call are already aware of this opportunity and have assessed, you know, whether this is something they want to pursue. But if you have not, I would really encourage you to drop everything and take a look, because it might take you a few days to pull all of the documentation together that you would need to apply. And again, it is only 5 days away, that deadline. So if we want to go to the next slide, just qu- quickly, a couple of points about this funding that's available. At the fourth phase, the phase that they're currently accepting applications for, it includes $8.5 billion that they're planning to make available for rural providers. I do want to note that most of the time when we talk to the federal government, they don't consider any part of New Jersey to be rural. The Census Department has ways of defining rural, and none of New Jersey qualifies. However, my understanding is that HRSA is using an alternative definition of rural for this purpose, and that it may include some limited areas of New Jersey. So I would just flag that for providers that I would not assume that you're not eligible for that. So there's the $8.5 billion for rural providers, and then on top of that $8.5 billion, there's an additional $17 billion, which is available for providers regardless of geography. And in order to qualify, providers need to document that they have revenue losses in the period from July 2020 to March of 2021. The formula that HRSA is planning to use to distribute these funds is quite complex, and I am not going to attempt to summarize it. I will just say at a high level that there are various inputs into that formula. It includes revenue losses that providers may have experienced, changes in expenses due to the pandemic. There are different pools of money available for different providers based on their size. And then total Medicare, Medicaid, and CHIP billing also is a factor in calculating the payments that are available to each individual provider. On top of that, my understanding is that the final sort of details of the formula that HRSA intends to use won't be finalized until after applications are received, so that HRSA can make sure that, you know, whatever formula they're using, the amount of money they have corresponds to the number of providers who have applied for support. So a lot of complexity here, some more detail to come. There is a lot more information on the HRSA website if you're interested in looking more closely. So if we can go to the next slide. So just wanted to quickly, as I mentioned, this is not a simple application. Just wanted to quickly flag some of what's needed. If you are going to apply, providers who apply for this funding are expected to provide significant documentation. This includes a list of billing TINs, internal financial documentation around changes due to the pandemic and tax returns. My understanding is that HRSA will then combine that data with the data that the federal government already has access to around Medicaid and Medicare reimbursement when calculating the amount of funding that each provider qualifies for. And they have been in contact with us and all state Medicaid agencies if they're having a challenge with identifying the correct data for a given provider around Medicaid reimbursement. So again, like I said, it's not a simple application. There is a lot of documentation that's required, and the deadline is coming up very, very soon on October 26th. So we would just strongly encourage any providers who think they may qualify to really look at that right away. And if you do have any questions, recommend following up with HRSA. We're of course happy to help however we can, but we're really not the subject matter experts on this. And I think there was a link on one of the earlier slides to the website that has all the information around this program.
Thank you so much. And thank you for the clip. Not only all the work you do, but the clarity you bring to it in helping make it accessible to all of us. Jen or any members of the MAAC, any comments or questions around provider relief funding? Hearing or seeing none, we will, with great thanks again to Greg for all these efforts. We'll now move to social drivers of health. Medicaid has always had a public health perspective, and more in the larger world, we're understanding that many of the factors that affect our health and well-being and services come out of the social environment. So it's very exciting to hear both about the housing that's proposed in the FMAP relief, and now to turn to this section. And I'll turn to Jennifer Jacobs to talk more about social drivers, specifically the Lifeline Free Smartphone and the Emergency Broadband Benefit. Assistant Commissioner.
Thanks, Dr. Spitalnik.
We started this conversation a little bit at our last MAAC meeting, sort of mentioned it as an aside and said that we would come back to the Lifeline free smartphone and really wanted to share some good information with you today. Also during the public health emergency, there's something called the emergency broadband benefit. So this is new and it is temporary during the federal public health emergency, but important for you to know about. You know, the pandemic itself has given us, everyone was already talking about social determinants or social drivers of health. We've been having this conversation, planning to build it into our 1115 renewal, building it in lots of other ways, separate from the 1115, making sure that it was always on the table and part of our discussions. But I will say that the pandemic brought that into sharp focus, right? And in a couple of specific ways, really up front at the very beginning, as you know, stores were, shelves were emptying out and stores were sometimes closing altogether. Congregate dining sites were closing. We saw food insecurity happening, in a very serious way for our members. And that was something that we jumped on with our health plans as we were doing high risk outreach work. Another thing that kicked up very early on in the pandemic was telehealth. And so the plans have been publicizing this free smartphone benefit through their websites and through care management. But the state, because it's a federal benefit, the state hadn't yet kind of created a state-based resource for this. And we now have, but I want to walk you through the benefit itself so that you can see what it's all about. And then we're excited to share the new website with you. So the free smartphone benefit is available broadly in the community, but every New Jersey Family Care household qualifies for this free smartphone through the federal program, just on the basis of they qualify for NJ Family Care, they qualify for this smartphone. But I want to put it on your radar that it's not only our members who qualify. And so it is worth getting to know the program if you're a community-based organization or advocacy group that might not have been familiar with this already, just broadly for the people you serve. And so this is a program that provides low-income households with a free smartphone and the wireless phone service you need to use that smartphone. And so that really means some free data, monthly minutes, and texting. And we see that as important for improving access to telehealth and care coordination, but also for being connected to providers and to natural supports, like having that cell phone and in particular smartphone can be really important. I think many of you are familiar with the relaxation of telehealth rules during the public health emergency. We don't know what will happen next with that at the federal level. And we're trying to make sure that we're at the table to hear what's going on at the state level. But previously, you really needed to have an encrypted platform for telehealth visit. And we didn't want to be in a place where, our members don't have access to telehealth because they don't have a cell phone. So hopefully a lot of those relaxations of rules during the pandemic will continue forward into the future. But in the meantime, we want to make sure that we're putting cell phones into as many people's hands as we possibly can. There's a couple of ways that people access this program. You can go to the federal website. I'm not sure I would highly recommend that you do that. And that's why it's not on this page. The federal website is really hard to follow, but there are two providers who offer the wireless service here in New Jersey. And that's how somebody can sign up for the free smartphone. They are Assurance and SafeLink. So we've given you those websites because it's a little bit of a quicker path, if that makes sense, to getting to that cell phone. And it's important to note that the public health emergency has led to this emergency broadband benefit, which I will talk about in a minute. And someone who has the smartphone can access that emergency broadband benefit a little bit differently than somebody who doesn't. So we'll come back to that in just a moment. The other thing I wanted to point out to you is the health plans have partnerships with these providers. So everyone can get a free smartphone through either of these providers. But if they have a particular health plan through NJ Family Care, they may want to check in with each provider to see if there's a some additional benefits that they may be able to access because of the particular plan. And you can see here, we've tried to give you the information that is current today for the partnerships that exist between the plans and the wireless service. But as you know, these things can change. So we wanted to make that information available to you. This is the free smartphone benefit that I've been talking about for a moment. Gets a little confusing, so stay with me as I go to the next page, and you're gonna see that same diagram. On the next page, there's Assurance and SafeLink again on the right, but now we're talking about the emergency broadband benefit. And this, as I said, is being provided during the federal public health emergency. And it is meant to support households accessing internet service. As you know, many, many aspects of society shifted from face-to-face experience to online, online platforms, just as we did here with the MAAC meeting. And so that is recognized here, that people need access to broadband. And there are a couple of different ways that households can access the emergency broadband benefit. One way is through that free cell phone we talked about a minute ago. Households that have that free Lifeline cell phone can get unlimited talk, text, and data on their Lifeline phone through the emergency broadband benefit. And households that don't want to access the broadband benefit that way could also choose to receive a discount on broadband service, up to $50 a month, which is not small dollars. So we want people to be aware of both options. It's your option, you know, each household can choose which one to go with. So for example, if you had a Lifeline phone, but you didn't want the unlimited talk, text, and data, and you really needed the emergency broadband, you know, the $50 discount at home because of kids doing online after school activity or whatever, and certainly if school's closed again, but every parent in the room is saying, please don't let that happen. You could elect the discount instead of the unlimited talk, text, and data. We are really excited about the unlimited talk, text, and data because we just feel like it opens up telehealth options for folks, and that feels really important. So a couple of ways to access the emergency benefit. If a household wanted to go with that unlimited talk, text, and data through the Lifeline smartphone, they can talk to their service provider, Assurance or SafeLink. You see why we included that same diagram on the second page. And if they wanted the broadband discount, we've provided information here on how to access that broadband discount. At the bottom of this page, you see the website that we've developed, Digital Access for All, and you can go to that site to get essentially the same information I've provided here, but it lets you sort of forward the link rather than forwarding our giant MAAC slide deck. And we're gonna continue to build that site out over time. It is simple because it is intended not to confuse people, right? Just give people the simplest path to the program. It is a federal program, but we're really trying to just support access. And we're going to continue to work with our managed care organizations to make sure that our households, our New Jersey Family Care households, are aware of this benefit. So Dr. Spitalnik, last time we got together, folks had interest in this. We wanted to give you everything we've got on it. It's another, as Greg said, you know, it's a federal program, so we're not the subject matter experts per se, but we have done a deep dive here to try to make sure that we're giving people access to this program as much as possible. And last thought, there is a New Jersey program called Lifeline that is utility assistance. And so it's unfortunate that we have a federal Lifeline and a New Jersey Lifeline. Those are two different programs that actually, you know, have a lot of overlap in terms of eligible populations. But we are excited to continue to promote this benefit so that we're making sure people have access to services, including and especially telehealth.
Thank you so much for the clarity of this, and we all trip over acronyms and the multiple use of these really affirmative labels for programs. I will call everyone's attention to the fact that in the chat, you can copy the link for this program. And at this juncture, I will ask if there are any comments or questions from the members of the MAAC for about this program, understanding that your transferring application information to all of us. Any comments or questions? At this point, let me add, and I'll thank one of our stakeholders for saying that in addition to having an a paper application through the 800 number, that there can be assistance in filling out the application by calling 833-511-0311. And I'll ask that that number be put in the chat, and also noted that Comcast has Comcast Essentials. That is also a program for internet access. So that concludes our agenda, except for our forward look. And we wanted to be visible on the screen as we look towards the planning for our next meeting, which is January 27th, 2022. So far in my notes, there is interest in the implementation around the FMAP opportunities and stakeholder involvement. There's a request for information about behavioral health integration and specifically behavioral health services for the intellectual and developmentally disabled population. We will also be requesting an update on the progress of the comprehensive waiver, both submission and any response that there's been for CMS. Beyond being able to read my own handwriting, what other things would MAAC members or DMAS suggest for our next agenda?
It's not an agenda item, but I thought I saw in one of the slides that we have to meet to approve something on, I saw September 13th. Did I misread that? I thought it said MAAC that there was a, did I misread that?
Jennifer? I don't know. Maybe an 11:15 thing, Greg?
Yeah.
Nothing's coming to mind.
I think maybe September, Mary Pat, I think September 13th may have been the date we held the special MAAC meeting on the 11:15 renewal, but I don't think there's any forward-looking thing that happened there.
It's always coming around again, Mary Pat.
No, I still think it's about to be summer, so we're all in COVID time warp. But just from a process point, let me clarify that we did not have minutes from that meeting, and because of the nature of that as a special meeting, and miraculously we are up to date with the approval of our minutes. But thank you for keeping us on track. Beverly, what would you like to say at this juncture?
I guess it would be great for Greg to be able to give us an update on the increased spend plan items that are still being discussed with CMS, which he probably would be doing anyway, to just sort of see where things are in general.
Thank you. From Teresa or Wayne, any other agenda items? seeing none from Teresa, hearing none from Wayne, we have, well, first let me again express our thanks and admiration to the Division of Medical Assistance and Health Services and Jen for Langer Jacobs' leadership, and Greg Woods' leadership in policy to have been responding to the needs of beneficiaries in the public health emergency, to keep the program on a forward roll, and to not losing the initiatives that are so important as the extraordinary demands upon New Jersey Family Care and all of the programs of the Department of Human Services. I also want to reflect on the attention to detail that the division puts into the MAAC meetings to ensure that there is clarity and transparency and opportunities for participation. We are struggling with both, of course, responding to state policy, but the challenge in assuring participation, which our virtual mode has increased, missing the close interpersonal action, but looking forward to the next year. At this juncture, we've made the determination that at least at the start of the year that our meetings will continue to be remote, and we continue to try to find ways to ensure through question and answer function that we fulfill both our requirement and our shared commitment to stakeholder input. So at this juncture, we are scheduled to meet virtually. All of these meetings for the next calendar year are 10 a.m. to 12 noon for Thursday, January 27th, 2022. That's hard to come out of my mouth, the 2022 part. April 28th, 2022, July 28th, 2022, and a year from now, October 27th. And so with the hope of giving everyone back 6 minutes in their life, per our schedule, do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
Adjournment doesn't require a vote. So I thank everyone again for their participation, and with wishes for good health, good holidays, well-being, and enjoying this beautiful fall. Thank you all, and we look forward to seeing you in the new year.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.